One of our greatest technical achievements in space has been the launch and deployment of the James Webb Space Telescope. As a small update, the mirror alignment phase of the mission has completed, and the results are simply stunning. The telescope is now fully focused in all instruments, and get this, its optical performance is exceeding expectations. This telescope is better than it was designed to be. Now comes the final stage before beginning its science mission, which appears may happen slightly earlier than expected, given that everything has basically gone flawlessly, a testament to the engineering that went into it. The next step is calibrating the instruments and preparing for the main mission, which could begin as early as June, but the good stuff will start coming down in July, in which case we should have stunning images very quickly, though even the test images are absolutely gorgeous. While JWST's main mission is to study the universe in its beginnings, also on the table is to try to characterize exoplanets. And while not a SETI instrument per se, JWST has the power to detect certain anomalies that could be technosignatures. Also on the table is trying to characterize the makeup of exoplanet atmospheres, which if successful may show the strange disequilibrium of atmospheric gases, like oxygen on Earth, that could indicate a biosphere on an exoplanet. If anything is found, then the debate begins as scientists eliminate any non-biological scenarios that could be responsible. But there are also unambiguous biosignatures that JWST could search for that really would have no other explanation than life or a civilization, such as certain atmospheric gases that, to be present in any detectable concentration, would need an industrial civilization producing them. One of these would be CFCs in the atmosphere, but also things like phosphine, and some non-standard gases that would not be biosignatures on their own, but in certain combinations could be. But beyond that, it would be very difficult to detect a pre-industrial civilization on an exoplanet. In other words, if aliens were looking at Earth from a distance of 2,000 light years, whether through a giant telescope or a technique like gravitational lensing, they would see the obvious biosignatures of oxygen and methane in our atmosphere, and know that this was due to a biosphere, but they would have no idea that the Roman Empire, the Mayans, China's empire, etc. were flourishing on this world. But there are a few possibilities for detecting and learning something about us. If they had an instrument like the JWST on a much larger scale, the first is the Vegetative Red Edge. JWST is uniquely suited for detecting this biosignature, and also monitoring it to see if it were being moderated by a civilization. The red edge is an infrared signature that Earth plants exhibit, where in certain IR frequencies, the plants become highly reflective, like mirrors. The effect has to do with the structure of their cells and how light is handled, but it's a very distinctive feature and should be detectable at a distance if the analog of plant life on an exoplanet works on similar rules to our own, or a close enough variation for some kind of effect to be seen. If this is ever detected by monitoring it, such as regular repeating variations in the signal indicating seasonal changes, or even some common life cycle that shows a periodic methane signature as vegetation rots, only to see it peak and disappear as the new life cycle begins. But there may be variations in the signal that appear unnatural, such as an abrupt drop in the signal that could indicate a harvest on a planet with global agriculture covering most of its surface. In this regard, we'd be hard to detect, because during the days of Rome, while agriculture was widespread, the population was lower, and much of the planet was still covered in vast amounts of natural forest. You probably couldn't tease the agriculture signatures out due to the overwhelming noise of the forests. Even if the civilization were close, say at Proxima Centauri, it would still to this day be difficult to detect the agriculture using this method. But it's not out of the realm of possibility with a large enough version of an alien JWST. But there's another method that while the Romans wouldn't have been detectable using it, we very well might. And it's a brand new technosignature which highlights that we haven't thought of all possible technosignatures we might see in the universe, much less look for them. In a paper by Jacob, Haqq-Misra and colleagues, link in the description below, they detailed that it may be possible to detect alien agriculture through a disruption of an exoplanet's nitrogen cycle. Nitrogen is of key importance to plant life on Earth. It's basically fertilizer and must be fixed in the soil for plants to live. In nature, this is mostly accomplished by the microbes, but ultraviolet light from the sun and even lightning can also contribute in producing it in a form that can make it into the soil. But then there's artificially applied fertilizer. One of the most used nitrogen-containing fertilizers in modern agriculture is anhydrous ammonia. Ammonia is NH3, and its usage may be a common feature among all analogs of plant life in the universe, and thus could conceivably be a basis for alien agriculture. But here's the thing. There's a difference between a natural nitrogen cycle and one that's being affected by the use of fertilizer. Specifically, you see rises in the levels of ammonia and nitrous oxide, and even N2, that may be unexplainable without widespread agriculture when coupled with the usual suspects such as oxygen, water vapor, methane, etc. It also implies advanced chemistry on the part of the aliens, because without industrial chemistry, this form of fertilization is very difficult. We create ammonia through the Haber-Bosch process, which allows us to create plenty of it easily and cheaply for our agriculture. Aliens may well know of this process as well. Specifically, there is one juxtaposition of chemicals that might be an obvious technosignature that the authors detail. If you see unusual abundances of nitrous oxide and ammonia, it could indicate industrial-scale agriculture is being practiced on an exoplanet. But there's a catch. You need a really huge population to see it. As huge of a population as Earth has, coming up on 8 billion, it's actually not that close to what Earth could support. This is termed the carrying capacity of a planet, and we're not sure what Earth's is. The number ranges from us already having passed it to as high as 14 billion. But there's a problem here. People have been making carrying capacity predictions for Earth since Thomas Malthus in the early 19th century, and not a single prediction has held up, especially the now infamous 1960s prediction that we would run out of aluminum by the 90s, which was made despite aluminum being infinitely recyclable and the most abundant metal in the Earth's crust. The reason those predictions haven't ever panned out is largely due to either an underestimation of the resources available, like aluminum, or just plain technological advancement. Malthus couldn't have predicted the dramatic leaps agricultural technology would make, and just how efficient it would become. Likewise, it's difficult to predict what's in the future, especially in regards to genetic modification of crops. So it could easily be that carrying capacity is far larger than we currently envision for an Earth-like world. And that's where the nitrogen cycle disruption becomes visible. The authors estimate that a population of 30 to 100 billion on a planet should make this technosignature detectable. This technosignature has an additional benefit that so long as the civilization survives, which could be millions of years or more, the technosignature of their active agriculture would likewise be visible long term, increasing the chances of detection. And there are other agricultural-related technosignatures that could potentially be detected. One of these might involve a tidally locked exoplanet orbiting a red dwarf that has a zone of habitability at the twilight point of that world. This is a so-called eyeball world, and might be something like the planets in the habitable zone of a star like TRAPPIST-1. Here the civilization might expand habitability to the dark side of their world using orbital mirrors reflecting sunlight onto the surface, and thus extend agriculture as their population grows, since any such eyeball planet would have much more limited carrying capacity than a planet like Earth. But as with any technosignatures, certain assumptions have to be made. In this case, you have to assume that the aliens would practice agriculture at all, or do it on a level that could be detected. This would be a problem if the alien population eats completely differently than we do, such as entirely carnivorous, or some other method of ingesting nutrients that only involves geology. Or they may be rare aliens and not maintain a large enough population to practice detectable agriculture. But in the end, the opposite could be true, in that in addition to being one of the earliest technologies civilizations across the universe discover, agriculture may be the most universal of all technologies in the universe. Even locked-in civilizations that live in oceanic environments on global ocean worlds might even practice some form of aquaculture if they hit upon intelligence and have suitable physiology for it. In short, the universe could be chocked full of exofarms. Thanks for listening. I am Futures and Science Fiction author John Michael Godier. In addition to currently pondering the existence of exocarrots, I'm also pondering 300,000 subscribers. Thanks everyone, and here's to many more years of keeping this content coming. This is a special number because when I posted my first video on this channel, I was expecting 300 views tops and maybe a subscriber. Clearly, I underestimated things a bit. And then there's Event Horizon, which is coming up on 232,000 subscribers. And soon there will be a third channel, as soon as Anna gets around to creating it. Not yet, though. Anna's currently out shopping for spare parts, and the possum is on vacation in the Himalayas, summiting Mount Everest in a first for possum kind. They're making leaps and bounds. Be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.